I aspire to be the world's leading student of church planting, not expert. That's one reason that I enjoy teaching it. Good to see all of you here on the first day of GA, and I just want to apologize because at the end of today, when you call back to somebody at home and they're like, how's the first day of GA? And you're gonna be like, there was this inspiring, spirit-filled worship that we started with, and then this really erudite gospel sermon that has reminded us why we're here and why we do what we do. And then these two guys got up back to back, and for an hour each, they alternated between crying and yelling at us about church planting. And I don't know why they did, and it just got better from there. So I apologize. Yes, Mike Moses, teaching elder, Presbyterian of the Central Carolinas, teaching elder of the Lake Forest family of churches. We're in the north side of Charlotte, North Carolina. Hey, something really cool happened last night on the way here. I was on the same plane as one of our EPC church planters from Winston-Salem, North Carolina, Gary McGee. So if you know him, beautiful church plant there in that part of the Carolinas. And Gary said something really interesting. He said the last time General Assembly was here at this church and he was in this room is when the Holy Spirit ruined his life. And sitting here in the middle of one of our sessions is when he heard the call of God to switch from being an associate pastor where he had been for over a decade into planting a church. The Holy Spirit speaks when we're at General Assembly. I'm asking the Holy Spirit to speak now in these next minutes as to every church session's role as a parent, partner, or patron church to one church plant at a time, just one at a time, in a serial manner over the coming years, which could turn this into a multiplying movement across our nation. I want to start with a prayer. Our church, when we were planted in, I planted Lake Forest with some friends in 1998, and then with our parent church, we were a partner to them and planted three more churches in the first 5 years of our congregation. In fact, is anybody from Warehouse 242 or Threshold EPC here? The rest of us are supposed to clap for you. You don't clap for yourself, Warehouse. And anybody from Threshold here? Anybody from Threshold here? All right, so we were a partner to our parent church planting those. And then in 2011, God led our session to begin considering, is he calling us to be a parent church now? And as we did that, we chose, I found this church multiplication prayer and we prayed it at every session meeting as we were praying about what is our role in church planting. Are we called to move from partner to parent of church plants? Would you stand and let's open this session with this prayer, everybody together, please. Out loud. Father, break us of the way we have tied our egos to our ministries. Forgive us of wanting to be the superstars and the heroes. Forgive us for engaging in turfism and allowing our individual ministries to define your kingdom. May we see that your kingdom is beyond anyone's local church. And may those of us that are pastors lead our churches in like manner. May our focus be for the love of you. May our mandate be to equip others to follow you. May the fruit of our hands be seen in a viral faith that is spreading all across our land through churches that are being multiplied. May the churches we plant play such a vital role in the healing of our cities and communities that non-believing leaders will beg us to come start churches where they are. When we stand and preach or sit and share, may we see the young men and women whom you are calling out to multiply. May we challenge them, equip them, send them, and be there for them. As a result of how we have served them. Such. But may we stand before you one day when a great smile appears across your face and we hear you say, well done, so let's party. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. You can have a seat. You know how it is when you're so into something, but the person you're talking to is not, and they're trying to feign interest? It's kind of like when I come home from a round of golf and I'm trying to describe to Angie the one hole I got a birdie on. And then I pulled out this club, and then she's got no time for that, no interest in it. We're a denomination that one of our four visionaries is church multiplication. I'm going to presume you're interested. It's okay. You don't have to be as much of a one-hit wonder, one-trick pony as me, and that's the only thing I know anything about. But if you're not interested, this is going to be really boring. I'm sorry. I've been an ordained teaching elder in the EPC for 30 years now, not since 1993. And I've only ever served in church plants, so that's kind of weird. I didn't plan on that at all. First, I was out of seminary. I was the youth guy hired for this little EPC church plant of 100 to 150 people in 1993 called Hope Church in Memphis, Tennessee, Cordova, Tennessee. Meeting in a school. It's Hope here. Go Hope. And I was there. And it turns out that I learned a lot. I was apprenticed to the master church planting pastor, Craig Strickland and Eli Morris. And it turns out the church growth secret for Hope EPC in Memphis as a church plant was to get rid of me. Because after I left, they became the largest Presbyterian church in America. So that's what they needed to do. But then I was called to plant Lake Forest EPC in Charlotte, North Carolina in 98. For the first 5 years, we were a partner church with our parent church, and we planted four churches together. They funded and we coached. And then since 2011, we've chosen to in addition to being partner churches to EPC church plants and sometimes patron, we've been called to be a parent church. And so we're now a family of churches that plants a new daughter church every 1 to 3 years. And we remain a family of churches, which makes all of our church plants parent churches and keeps our head in the game in that regard. Now my talk, things that I'm gonna talk about today, hopefully are actionable and strategic. That's my goal for this time. Actionable and strategic by elders, sessions, clerks of session, and pastors. And so as I talk about, though, this way, I could be mistaken, and I know I have been before, about, well, he's just looking at a technocratic, strategic way to do ministry. And there's some truth to that, but I do want to tell you what really this is about for me is that from a young age, I represent God's plan A like many of you. God's plan A is I grew up in a covenant home, and I knew the love of Christ for me at a young age. And at a very young age, up to this moment, the Holy Spirit has gifted me with an almost tactile sense of the presence of God with me at all times. The Holy Spirit has gifted me, as Romans 5 says, the Holy Spirit pours out the love of God into our hearts. The Holy Spirit has gifted me with a tactile sense of the love of God almost at all times. You know what, basically, I'm gonna talk about some strategic decisions and action points because I want more people, in the really powerful words from this morning's sermon, to experience the intimacy of the love with the triune God. That's just what I want. That's what I enjoy, and I want it for others. In the content that Tom Ricks just presented to us, which he's the right guy for our director because as their church plant, you just heard about it, he didn't even say the whole story, that each time they would start accumulating money to build their first building, they're like, no, let's give it away and invest in a church plant. And they did that 3 or 4 times while they were in a high school gymnasium. They weren't a mega church. They were a growing church. And I'm so proud, just admire that. And that was a challenge to Lake Forest as we saw what God was doing through them. But Tom made clear, and through Tim Keller's material, the actionable case that by increasing the rate of church planting, we may actually be able to see a remarkable regeneration of the percentage of Christians in North America. And so I want to talk about now, I'll put this on screen, how can the EPC become a Great Commission movement through church planting? And I by moving from addition to multiplication, and I'll explain what I mean by moving from addition to multiplication. And I want to begin with my punchline, because probably like my sermons, I'll run out of time at the end and just like read my last 3 points. So I want to be sure that the main big idea is clear up front. I want to, through prayer, love of the EPC, and broad study, and then Tom last week saying, dude, just talk about what's actionable next for church planting and the EPC. I'd like to talk about maybe a little bit the beginnings of a blueprint for how the EPC can be marked by church planting churches and turn into a gospel multiplying movement. My goal, this is my personal goal, I'm not in charge of anything here, is to spur motivation for growing to 5% of our EPC churches becoming church planting churches, or parent in our nomenclature, and the other 95% of EPC churches becoming serial partners or patrons or both to church plants, one church plant at a time. And I'm gonna put percentages on that as a goal for us. That's where we're going. I have a question, and it's this. Do androids dream of electric sheep? Anybody know that reference? Yeah, the science fiction short story that became the movie, Ridley Scott's epic Blade Runner film, my favorite film of all time. Well, the fact that I was asked to give this address to the entire GA less than a week ago freaked me out. I mean, really, you're my esteemed colleagues, most of whom exceed me and our church in missionality and or in theological acuity, and certainly in power of biblical proclamation. And yet the topic I was asked to address had a hint of familiarity. If androids do dream of electric sheep, Mike Moses certainly dreams of the EPC moving from a denomination that plants churches in an addition mathematical equation to the EPC becoming a church planting movement of multiplication. Yes, those androids dream of electric church planting sheep. That was a weird reference, sorry. My sons know I put something in every sermon that just to crack myself up, because I've been doing this a long time. And their favorite moments, they're now adults, their favorite moments looking back is, Dad, we just love it so much when you crack yourself up and nobody else laughs. They live out of town. The Christmas Eve and Easter, they're living for that moment now. It makes them so happy. Tom just made the point, along with we're so thankful for Dr. Keller, that the Great Commission equals church planting. You've probably read that before. Ed Stetzer, Tim Keller, Bob Roberts, Rick Warren, and the real authority, Tom Ricks, says that, and the EPC Book of Order, because the sacraments only belong to the church, and Jesus put the sacraments in the Great Commission. And so it's starting churches. And so ask a pastor, ask about any pastor. And yet, so those argue that our thought of, our conception of the Great Commission has gotten so broad that we've lost some of the specificity of it. For example, ask a pastor, would it be sinful for you and your church to not be involved or invested in starting other churches? Would that be sinful? Most would say, no, it's optional. If you ask that same pastor, would it be sinful for your church to not do the Great Commission? Our answer would be, heck yeah, that would be sinful. And I think this shows that our conception of the Great Commission has grown so broad that we've lost the power of specificity of what the 11 dudes who were sitting there that day looking around going, there's only 11 of us. What did they go do with the Great Commission? We have a clear historical record. They went and planted churches. That's what they did. And so the Great Commission, it includes each of us in our personal circles, showing the three questions, the three circles. But ultimately, the responsibility is to plant new gospel communities. In a survey by the Billy Graham Center for Evangelism in 2010, 85% of Protestant churches indicated financial involvement in missions. Which leads me to reply, what are the other 15% gonna say to Jesus on that great day? Only 85, what? Okay, the next point here, I just thought that was weird. And 28% indicated participating in helping a church plant financially. That means 28% surveyed of Protestant churches, engaged as some kind of a partner or patron to a church plant. That surprised me how high that is, but that's low for our goal in the EPC. And then, additionally, 3% of churches indicated taking some primary responsibility for starting a new church. And out of different studies and what people say, I'm going to suggest that the EPC needs to be at 5% of our member churches taking primary responsibility for the start of one more new church. And then one more new church with a lot of partners and patrons together for us to get to multiplication and not addition. 5% of our member churches need to take a primary responsibility for helping a church financially. One church plant at a time, no matter over how many years. Because according to Rick Warren, this is repeating, the single most effective method for fulfilling the Great Commission that Jesus gave us is to plant new churches. 2,000 years of Christian history have proven that new churches grow faster, reach more in church people than established churches. The growth on any plant is always on the newest branches. And so we want to have a clear and compelling vision here in the EPC that calls for every local congregation, regardless of our size or age, to somehow make church multiplication a fundamental component of our evangelism strategy. And so a goal for the EPC to move from addition to multiplication, if I could just state it, again, I'm not in charge of anything. I have a golden gavel from my years as moderator, but it has no authority anymore. I can't bang it on anything here. A goal would be churches planting churches that in turn plant churches. For that to become as common and normal as churches with one more worship service and as common as churches sending mission teams. Not for every one of us to be the multiplying church, but that any churches any of us invest in as a parent, partner, or patron, can we put that back up on screen, por favor? That we're any church we're invested in as a parent, partner, or patron, it's investing in church plants that in turn plant churches. That's the multiplication principle there. Thank you, I appreciate that. Our last 10 years in the EPC of owning a church planting, there's really succeeded. Tom's leadership, Jeff Jeremiah's leadership, the church planting team, all of our moderators through this time has really succeeded at, like, we just own it. It's in the water. Nobody's like, no, that's stupid. Why are we talking about planting churches? There's just a lot of affection for church planting and church plants that's just in the water. And that's just a success, I think. Thank you, Lord, for that. But what I think can happen now is to move from addition to multiplication over the next generation of the EPC. And the only way that happens is that every church we plant becomes a multiplying church with the understanding that that's who they will be. I grew up, back to the Great Commission, equal church planting. I grew up hearing everyone refer to Paul's travels, and it was in the back pages of my Bible, so it was true, as missionary journeys. But I traced that journey on an academic study with my family in Paul's steps, and I'm like, that's a misnomer. My Bible was wrong. Okay, the back parts, which are not inerrant or infallible. And now I insist on calling them Paul's church planting journeys because that's what they were. I have three action points that I just hope they're specific enough to not be like trying to make me do stuff, but I hope they're specific enough to be like, that's something actionable. And I can either say yes or no. Like, is God calling me to that, us, our church, or not? Number one, each EPC church becomes an evangelistic and multiplying church by being a parent. I'm gonna advocate that we need to measure that we get to 5% of churches who are a parent church taking primary responsibility for the launch of one new church, however many years it takes. I don't care if it's 10 years. Partner churches need to be 55% who are investing significantly financially and in prayer and in relationship with a church plant. It'll take a few partners for every church. And if at least 45% of our denomination are patrons. We're supporting the way that we support missions, missionaries, and things, one church plant at a time. And then when that one no longer needs our support, we pick another one. The Apostle Paul says that every member in the church is a different body part with a different important function. No function's more or less important. And to not despise any part of the body, but esteem them all, and to play our part well. Which is your part of the body of Christ called the EPC? Your church. Because each of us are here representing our church. Which is your part in the body of Christ called the EPC? Parent, partner, or patron with one church plant that we have the expectation will be a multiplying church within their first 3 to 5 years. I've spoken with more than one pastor, and I Zoomed with at least 2 sessions this year who are praying about, is the Holy Spirit calling them to be a partner church where they invest at a significant level with church plants initiated elsewhere, or is God calling them to be a parent church? And the Holy Spirit is gonna give us initiative. We might not know where or how. We didn't know where or how when we started, and we heard from the Holy Spirit as we prayed that prayer that we all started with a minute ago. We heard parent for Lake Forest. Which is it for your church? What part in the body of Christ? And that will move us from addition to multiplication. I also want to rejoice. I was witness to something joyful this year. I got to witness a church making a decision to be a patron of an EPC church plant this year for the first time. They gave a financial gift to one of our new church plants that was significant to them from their missions budget, and it was significant to the church planter, although it was not some huge number. Notice my caveat at the end of that last slide, if we can maybe slap that one back up there. At the end of this potential method for us, in a repeating manner. Hey, we partnered with a church plant. Woo, good on us. Thank you, Jesus. That's good. Take all the joy you can from that. Let's take a break. In a serial manner is what will lead to multiplication. Okay, which is the next little baby that gets to be cute that our church is gonna love on and put up baby pictures and celebrate it when they take their first step? Which is the next little baby? Because that's good for our churches to have children. How does it get annualized? How do things get annualized or repeated or serialized in our churches? How does that happen? So that they happen year after year without you, the pastor, or you, the session, having to bring it up all again like it's a new item, and the session has to have a 3-hour discussion. Are we gonna do this again next year or not? How do things get annualized? How do they get repeated? How do they get serialized? When they get budgetized. I just told you I'm gonna be practical about action steps. It's all just want to. Till something gets budgetized. And when it gets budgetized, then somebody on session has to say, I'm against that in next year's budget. Who wants to be that person? Not me. I don't want to be that guy. So action step for sessions: to institutionalize church multiplication in an annual budget line. No matter how much or little, start with $5. Send it to a church plant. Boom, you're a patron. Is it in your missions budget? Is it evangelism? Because maybe we don't have a line item for evangelism. This would be a way to do it. Is it a new budget? I don't know. I can't tell you how your budget works. But when it gets in the budget, it will be, when it's budgetized, it'll be annualized. And that will unlock church multiplication potential. Pick your level, parent, partner, or patron. That's what I'm asking the Holy Spirit to be hovering over the waters here. And moving in the minds of ruling and teaching elders, are we called to be a parent, partner, or patron? Which, there's not a better in the body of Christ, but which is it? But it's gonna take at least 5%. It's gonna take a number of new churches stepping into the role of parent church with fear and trepidation. One church I know heard the word parent from the Holy Spirit recently, probably because church planting is in the water in our denomination. And they heard that word parent. It's not a mega church in the EPC. And they are now saving, I think the figure was $5,000 or $10,000 a year until the point they feel called to, where's the church plant? And we have enough dry gunpowder. And they're also already talking to other EPC churches in their presbytery about partnering with them when that time comes. B-A-utiful. They've budgetized it, so now it's annualized. Let me ask a related question. What is my church or your church's evangelism strategy? Man, God really did a work last year at GA with the material we learned about relational evangelism, and there's a renewal happening there. But what is your church's evangelism strategy? Most churches don't have one. In a 2007 Christianity Today article, this was asserted. Church planting has replaced crusade evangelism as the preferred evangelistic method for evangelicals in North America. Yeah, keep going with the three questions, the three circles method of personal evangelism, but evangelism at the church-wide level is not going to be a crusade or a big evangelistic event for almost any of us. So what is it? Well, church planting has replaced that. Let's be part of this Spirit-led movement in North America. Session, this is low-hanging fruit for evangelistic momentum in every church. If you make church planting a part of your evangelism strategy as a parent, partner, or patron, or if you do, if you have a strategy or not, you can make it part of it or make it. Vote for it. Put it in the budget under evangelism. Invest it. Celebrate evangelistic fruit back to the church going, well done, church. Look, through your giving, we gave to this church plant. Look at the evangelism that happened. Let me give you an example. We have currently our most recent church plant in the Lake Forest family of churches is Lake Forest Church, U City. It's near the University of North Carolina at Charlotte. And church planter Terrell sitting in the front row. And they celebrated, they're a blessedly multi-ethnic expression of the gospel. And our first baby church plant, they were 6 months old and they had their first adult baptisms last October. And they took a video of it in the YMCA pool. What did I do the next Sunday at my church, Lake Forest Huntersville? I showed the video and we took full credit for those baptisms. I said, look how your giving is leading to the spread of the gospel in our city. Well, take joy, y'all. Well done. I took full credit. I mean, we gave a little credit to you, Terrell. Just a little. But I gave it to our congregations. Those of you who give at Lake Forest, I'm not shy to talk like that. Look what God did. This is legacy stuff. This is evangelism. And they broke out in applause. And we're not that particularly emotional of a congregation. I am. I do all the emotional on behalf of the whole congregation. that's kind of true. Aaron, okay, I need to think about that and talk to my counselor. We leverage the evangelistic success as a parent church. We've done it with one of our partner churches. They held some baptisms. We're not the parent. We're not coaching them. We're not their primary sponsor, but we have a pretty significant for us annual gift for 3 years. So evangelism happened. We showed the baby pictures to our church. Look at the baby. It's so cute. It's new life. Y'all, this is evangelism joy in our congregations. Jesus says in his mission statement of the three parables back to back in Luke 15, there's rejoicing in heaven with the angels of God when one sinner repents. Let's give that rejoicing to our congregations. It's right there. Our churches need it. The older of a church we are, including mine now that I pastor, the less adult conversions we see annually. We need the joy of that from our church plants, and that happens if we're vitally invested as a parent, partner, or patron. Listen, here's the cheat code. Sessions, y'all could decide. Next year's budget is terrible. We got no extra money. We got to cut some money. But we're going to find $2 to be a patron, and we're going to pick one church plant and that we think might have some baptisms and send it to them. And then if you only send $2, first of all, say, you're not getting our $2 unless you send us a video or pictures of when you baptize people. Be transactional in that regard, okay? And then when they send that to you, celebrate it like it was $10,000 you invested. Hey, when you give at our church, look at the evangelism that God is doing And we pray that we'll be invested more and more. I'm saying that only partly tongue-in-cheek about the $2 part, because you have to start somewhere. Because then that question is how will my church find the money for this? Mike, that's really nice of you to just invent pretend monopoly money in my church that doesn't exist. Easy for you to say. It was hard for me to say at Lake Forest. We were now a full-blown existing church in 2011 when God led us to become a parent church. And we planted our first daughter church out of special money we raised as part of a capital campaign. Lake Forest Church Davidson, which is now Story Hill Church, under the pastorship of Michael Flake, one of their elders is here in the front row with us as well. And that was out of a capital campaign, but one of the things we did, a good job of leveraging that for joy back to our congregation and our session. When Davidson would have baptisms and new members, we leveraged it for joy. So the session, one of our elders in particular, by golly, by gum, this is gonna get budgetized because we can't just do one. And so he twists, after praying that multiplication prayer that we prayed at the beginning of the session, we prayed at every session meeting, and he finally got around to, by the Holy Spirit and manipulation, more him than me, getting our session to approve in perpetuity 3% of all monies given in the future to Lake Forest every year will now be a church multiplication fund. And I didn't know where that was going to come from in our budget. It was a full budget. And by the way, we had just given away a lot of giving to Story Hill EBC Church, the wealthiest zip code in our part of Charlotte. I didn't think about that ahead of time. And so it just, our ministry staff for the next 3 years, they're like, hey, you know, we're a pretty full church. Things are going good around here. How come our budgets have been cut? I said, gee, I don't know. It's a mystery. I didn't tell them it was because we started 3% of the budget for church planting, because then they would have hated our church plants. It was a mystery why everyone's budget was cut. And then we just grew into it. Is it 1% of your missions budget and you're going to grow it each year? Is it that the next time a missionary retires and comes home and you celebrate their work, that's now becomes in perpetuity your partnership or patron annual amount, and you pick one church plant and you invest that in them, and then when they're grown up and don't need it, you pick another and another in a serial manner. I don't know how for you, but I know you can. And partly, sometimes you think, well, we'd have to give a lot of money for it to be substantial because church plants cost a lot of money. And in some cases they do, but they don't all have to. Sharing the gospel, making disciples, and baptizing people is free, last time I checked. Don't have the conception every church plant has to start with this kind of a band and a setup and a technology, and so our small investment would be insignificant. God has a preference for small churches and small church plants because 90% of them are. He loves the small church. He loves the small church plant. You just invest whatever it takes to start the church and then let God decide the size. We don't always have to invest at the level of thinking, presuming it's going to be large. Here's what this is going to take. Senior pastor, clerk of session, or one other elder like our elder, Jack. It's going to take one of you saying, I've heard the Lord. We're going to deal with this. We're going to decide. Is the Holy Spirit calling us to be a parent, a partner, or patron of a church plant, one at a time, year after year, that's all, not 50, just one at a time. What's our part? And wouldn't it be joyful as part of our evangelism and to reflect baby pictures back to the church when there's new life? Because really, all of our actual disciples of Jesus are here, and they would be most motivated by seeing one more person come to faith in Jesus. Because I've been in a lot of your churches because of some of my roles. They're beautiful. And they're filled with members and elders and pastors who love the gospel. And they want to see people come to faith in Jesus. And we've just learned from Tom that the normative way the Holy Spirit does that is in new congregations in their first 15 years of life. So let's cooperate with what the Holy Spirit normally does and help them get started, be a parent, partner, patron, and then mine the joy out of it like a healthy family gets joy from a child or a baby or a grandbaby. Who here has ever tried, made a motion to kill your missions budget or prayer ministry in your church? Of course, nobody's here who's done that because you would have been fired from being a leader in your church. Well, I'm just gonna say this the way I would say it. Evangelism through church multiplication must be institutionalized in EPC churches to the point where the thought of killing it in next year's budget would be just as ridiculous as a motion to kill the mission budget? Fire the prayer team? What are you smoking? Right? It needs to be the same. I'm getting too exhortational. It can be the same level of ridiculousness if we began to equate Great Commission, church multiplication, evangelism in the way that I think the New Testament clearly does. And so every church here could pick one church plant in Presbytery or nationally at a time. You hear how that's just a bite of the cheeseburger? Just pick one. Give some money and prayer and love for 3 to 4 years. Then pick another. Then another, like a supported missionary. We're very familiar with how this works, but not in the area of church multiplication. And if this becomes the norm in the EPC, and if we require denominationally, every church planter begins with a commitment and a strategy to multiply and plant a new church within their first 3 to 5 years, this will end up in gospel movement multiplication, and untold souls will be saved. Now, I'm gonna focus in on one of these categories for my second action point. And don't worry, the third one's really short. My second action point, I'm asking for some of you ruling and teaching elders of certain churches to listen. I'm asking for your kindness toward me to entertain these thoughts. Those of you ruling and teaching elders at large churches, at medium-sized churches, and at small churches who have a strong identity of being a missional church. This is number two action point. Many more EPC churches must become a parenting church of church plants who also have to count on many partner churches to join them. Thank you for those of you who are partner churches with us in a couple of our Lake Forest church family plants. We can't do it without partners. That's just beautiful to me. There's a new study by Exponential and Lifeway Research completed in 2020, 2021, that there is an uptick in North America from 20 years before of churches taking significant parenting or partnering, that's our language, responsibility for new church plants. What I'm saying is this is something the Holy Spirit is doing in our generation, and we're invited to take an increasing part in it. In essence, church multiplication is increasingly the action of churches planting churches and subsequently often planting their own networks. It's becoming the new normal in North American church planting. Although Bob Logan and many others had begun writing about church multiplication in the early 1990s, it wasn't until a little over a decade ago that the paradigm for church planting in North America began shifting from addition to multiplication. And what this means is instead of just planting growing churches, we focus our vision and strategies on planting reproducing churches, where every church planter henceforth has a strategy and a will and a determination and a commitment that they will multiply within 2 to 5 years, and that the rest of us are marshaled to be parents, partners, and patrons in that regard. Because if a denomination or network continues to be the primary force behind planting churches, we'll never reach multiplication. It'll depend on the institution. But a church multiplication movement, now I'm giving you a technical term, is when there's rapid reproduction of churches planting churches, with the denomination giving an assist with all the expertise and training and pathways and pipelines that they can do. One denominational director said this about their denomination: our denomination's goal over the next 12 years is to have 4% of our churches in our denomination become a parent or multiplying church. We believe 4% is a tipping point. That's why I'm calling it 5% for the EPC. Of churches who identify as we're called to be a parent church. Action step for pastors and elders. I don't know why I wrote pastors. In 5% of our member churches, appoint a church multiplication committee team or commission. We had a task force, and then once we were committed, we turned it into a commission of session that me and one of our ruling elders co-chairs. But start with appoint a committee team, task force, commission. Place it powerfully in the organizational structure. Instruct them to begin with prayer, study, and a deadline to deliver a plan to session. Take them a parent, partner, or patron. But in this case, I'm saying, I'm encouraging many of you to actually ask the Holy Spirit, are we called to become a parent or a multiplying church? I don't mean that you have the capacity to do 10 a year or 10 a decade. I just mean, can we keep that up there? That's way better than looking at me. Because I just really appoint a team, place it in the organizational structure with some power, instruct them to begin with prayer, study, and a deadline, because we are Presbyterian, to deliver a plan to session to become a parent church. And I would say also, or a partner church, but it'll take 5%. One Pentecostal denomination that has a high church planting rate, twice our rate, they gather all the multiplying or parent churches into a network they call the Antioch Network. That sounds kind of cool to me. I want to tell you some stories, okay? Let me tell you about Valley Hope EPC in Black Mountain, North Carolina. This is a picture of them at worship from their website. Anthony, I hope I got a good one. You know what Valley Hope has been doing? I mentioned them earlier. They've been setting aside a few thousand dollars a year because they're called to be a parent church. They think that's what God has equipped them to do. They're a really healthy, growing church. They're not a mega church. And they're gonna put it aside for however many years it takes. And they are organizing so they have a plan when that day comes, and they'll know when to pull the trigger to initiate a daughter church plant. And Pastor Rodriguez is already actively inviting other EPC churches in the region to be partner church to them as parent. Dude, perfect picture. The only thing to add, Anthony, is that the church planter has to be committed to multiplication within years 3 to 5. That's what needs to get added to our strategy. I'm not the boss of anybody, but I'm just suggesting it, okay? Let me, on the other side of America, Chapel and in the EPC, Chapel Hill EPC in Gig Harbor, Washington State. Have we had a GA there yet? If so, I didn't get there. Why, Scott? Okay, because I want to go to Seattle. Chapel Hill EPC, Gig Harbor, they had a successful capital campaign to pay off mortgage debt that they had held for over a decade or two. And when they paid off the mortgage, Pastor Mark Toon then proceeded to give himself a huge monthly raise equivalent to the former mortgage payments. No, Mark didn't do that. He and his visionary session at Gig Harbor set aside. They didn't piratize that money. Oh, now we can have multicolored goldfish in the children's ministry. We can upgrade everything, you know, our programs. They set aside that former mortgage money between mission projects and new church plants. They took up a calling to be a parent church. I didn't mean anything by multicolor. They took up a calling to be a parent church there. They budgeted a specific amount. I presume, I don't know this, I'd love to know, that there's a committee who stewards that vision of a certain amount of that. Let's talk. And out of that fund, they planted the first daughter church, Port Orchard Church, with Pastor Megan Hackman. Is Megan at GA this year? Okay. And it's called, she's getting ready to have a baby. You are excused. they're now called Hepzibah House Church. And Chapel Hill is now thinking, what's our next church plant? Because they annualized because they budgetized, and in their case, it was their mortgage amount. So now they're thinking, what's the next one? And now their daughter, Hepzibah House Church, will be a partner to the parent, and it just goes from there. And they will require, I'm saying in faith, their next church planter to have a plan for multiplication within the first 5 years. Have I repeated that enough yet? Apparently not. Okay. I'm going to skip over this next slide because it is really interesting to me but boring to everybody else. We'll skip that one and we'll skip the next one. I'm going to skip that story. Senior pastor, clerk of session, elder owning the Holy Spirit gut that God has given you as a shepherd on behalf of God's flock. It will take one of us at each church to say, I won't take no for an answer. This has got to be part of our evangelism. Asking God, we're connectional for a reason. We're not an independent church. We believe connectionalism is biblical. That's why I'm a Presbyterian, by the way. At our church, we call it Presbyterian with a small p, to make the point that first and foremost, we are submitted connectionally because that's a New Testament principle. Every church is submitted to others for right doctrine and right practice. And we've chosen to do that in the EPC, and I love the EPC. But we're here for a reason, and so I think that is incumbent upon each of us and some of you to take away a burden to pray this and to speak it in your session, which one is the Holy Spirit calling us to be. Now, let me end with this, I think. What I'm talking about is old school. It's not new school. I mean, it is something new the Holy Spirit's doing, but it's old school. It's as old school, new school, like Second Presbyterian Church, Memphis, EPC, one of my hero churches. Anybody here from Second Pres? Hey, what's up, you guys? Good to see you all. Some of my friends. Dude, you know what Second Pres has been doing for 50 years? 50 years. What was the combined tenure of Pastor DeWitt and then Sandy? Ish. 55 years? Boom. Okay, John, 38. John, how many years is your tenure as an elder, John Adamson? He said he can't count that high. It's a lot, longer than even those two senior pastors. I just want to say, this is in old Memphis, a tall steeple church, no doubt. A beautiful worshiping church. We had GA there. And for 50 years, not one of their senior pastors has ever planted a church or studied it or anything. And yet, this church, that's just a good old EPC church. I mean, a gooder than most EPC church, in my opinion. This is solid, just doing the stuff. And yet, I don't even know why I didn't call you ahead of time to find out, because I don't need to know why. That would be helpful maybe in the future as a case study on an All Things podcast, perhaps. I don't know why. But for 50 years, every 3, 5, 10 years, you guys plant a daughter church. I so admire that. So it's old school. It's new school, but it's old school. And if every one of our churches that considers ourselves in any remotely way healthy can take Second Pres as our icon for this, like they just, I hope it's like in a strategy that keeps coming and your session has to decide every 5 years, what's our next church plants? I don't know how it's become so regular, but it has been. And by the way, now when they plant churches, two or three of their daughter churches, Hope or St. Patrick or other ones, they're all partners and it just multiplies. They're a beautiful example of what could turn into a multiplying movement if our healthy churches take the gifts God's given us, no more, no less. Take up our step. In the EPC, we're just responsible for us moving from addition to multiplication by every church. 5% a parent, 55% a partner, which is significant annual contribution for at least 3 years to a church plant, and 45% a patron of church plants that are required to be multiplying churches within their first 3 to 5 years. Oh, what a beautiful equation for gospel multiplication and for all of us to have occasion to show baby pictures in our congregations of new life in Christ because we were a partner, patron or parent to a church plant. Oh, would you stand? Let's close the session this way. I had a session for our church planters, a point, but I'll save that for the retreat. If I'm able to. Let's pray this prayer one more time. Any details I need to give before lunch, Michael's gonna take care of that. Okay, Y'all ready? Father, break us of the way we have tied to our ministries. Forgive us of wanting to be the superstars and the heroes. Forgive us for engaging in turfism and allowing our individual ministries to define your kingdom. May we see that your kingdom is beyond any one single local church. And may those of us that are pastors lead our churches in like manner. May our focus be for the love of you. May our mandate be to equip others to follow you. May the fruit of our hands be seen in a viral faith that is spreading all across our land through churches that are being multiplied. May the churches we plant play such a vital role in the healing of our cities and communities that non-believing leaders will beg us to come start churches where they are. When we stand and preach or sit and share, may we see the young men and women whom you are calling out to multiply. May we challenge them, equip them, send them, and be there for them. May the story of our lives be not just what we have done as a result of how we have served them. May we serve with such humility that our names are barely known here. Let's hold. Just silent for a moment. Just talk to the Holy Spirit about your church. Holy Spirit, speak. Holy Spirit, lead. Holy Spirit, guide. And now the final line of the prayer together. But may we stand before you one day when a great smile appears across your face and we hear you say, well done, so let's party. Amen.
Amen, amen, amen. Thank you, Mike.